Hello, this is Professor Jim A. Chan at California State University, Long Beach. In this video lesson today, we'll look at how to graph and model piecewise functions. I'm going to show you the thought process through examples. Sketch the graph of the following function. The first thing you should notice that is that there are two pieces to this graph, and the splitting point is defined by this portion of the information. Notice that you're going to use the first piece, which is the x squared piece, for x values that is less than or equal to 1. And then you're going to use the second piece, which is the 2x plus 1, if x values is greater than 1. So my suggestion to you is that once you lay down your coordinate system, you immediately identify where the splitting point is. In this case, x equals 1. And then you're going to realize that to the left of the splitting point, we're going to try to graph the equation y equals x squared, because that's the first piece. And then to the right of the splitting point, we're going to use the second piece, which is the y equals 2x plus 1. And as we're trying to graph those two pieces, we're going to use prior knowledges about known functions, such as the x, x squared, and x cubed, or square root, or absolute value functions that you have already graphed before. First thing you do is actually figure out where that endpoint is located on the coordinate plan. Well, when x is equal to 1, I evaluate this function at 1, I will use the first piece, which is 1 squared, that gives me 1. So this tells you that the point 1, 1, now this one here comes from using the x value 1, and this one here comes from the output value after the function evaluation. This means that the graph should go through the point 1, 1, which is right about here on the coordinate plan. And to the left of it, it's just going to follow the parabola curve. Hopefully you have some general knowledge about what the parabola curve looks like. In particular, for this parabola graph, it should go through the point 0, 0. And it should also go through the point negative 1, 1, which is right here. And it should also go through the point negative 2, 4, which is right there. So now if you connect those points here, it should give you the parabola curve. I'm going to put the arrow on the left-hand side here because it technically extends forever to the left. Add the x values are near 1, but not exactly equal to 1. I'm going to use the second piece, which is the 2x plus 1 function. Now, if it were to go through x equals 1, what function value would it have? You actually get f of 1, which is 2 times 1 plus 1. That means if x equals 1 is an allowable point that you can use to graph the second piece, it should go through the point 1, 3, which is right here. But because you cannot use x equals 1 for the second piece, that means we're actually going to put an open circle at that point to indicate if it were to include that, it would be starting right there. But we're not going to include it because x value can only be strictly greater than 1. And then we're going to finish that piece by using prior knowledge about this equation, which we know is a linear equation with the slope of 2 and y-intercept of 1. For a line with the slope of 2, we're going to go up 2 units and run over to the right 1 unit to land at our second point. So 2 units, 1 here, 1 there, and up, and then to the right 1 unit to give us that second point there. Now, if we were to connect those two points, it would give my straight line like that. As a general rule of thumb, as you're graphing the piecewise functions, your first step is to identify your splitting point. And then from that point on, you want to do function evaluations on the left piece and the right piece. Well, sometimes it could be multiple pieces, not just the two pieces, but you want to figure out the function values on each of those pieces and label it accordingly depending on whether or not that point is included in your graph, and finish each piece using prior or known knowledge about the curves. For this next example, let's try to think the opposite way. Here, I'm going to give you a graph. I want you to find a formula for the function that looks like the following. The strategy is to first identify points where changes occur. Start from the left side of the real number line. You notice that the first graph we encounter is a horizontal line, and it stopped being a horizontal line as soon as we hit the point x equals negative 1. And then it's going to continue on in the pattern of a straight line, right here, and stop at point x equals 2. And then once you reach that point, it's just going to continue on with the horizontal line for the rest of the time. For this function, we're going to have three pieces to it. The first piece here, which could be determined later, we know that it's going to be good until x equals negative 1. So everything to the left of that is good and until negative 1. So the domain for that first piece is all x values that is less than or equal to negative 1. And just to reiterate, we need to include the equal sign here because it is a solid dot at this point. For the second piece, it's good between negative 1 and 2, inclusive on the 2, but exclusive on the negative 1. So the domain for that second piece here is going to be x greater than negative 1 and less than or equal to 2. I'm going to figure out what the actual function is later. And the domain for the last piece is going to be everything greater than 2. It's strictly greater than because it's an open circle here. Now we're ready to actually figure out what the function description is for each piece. We'll start with the easiest one here, which are the horizontal lines. So these are just constant numbers. Now the first piece is going to be, looking at the y value here for that first horizontal line, is going to be 1. This third piece here is also easy as well because it's also a horizontal line, and then it has a fixed y value at negative 2. The middle piece is the one that actually needs a little bit of work. We need to figure out a slope and also the y-intercept. Well, the y-intercept is easily available because it is where the line intersects the y-axis, which is at 1. You can figure out the slope by traveling from one point to the next. Going from this point, for example, to this point here, we first go down 1 unit and then to the right 1 unit. So that corresponds to a negative 1 over 1 slope, which is negative 1. So altogether, we have a negative x plus 1. So to recap, the general strategy to figure out a function description for piecewise graphs is to first identify points where splitting happens, and to figure out the domain for each piece first, and then go backwards to figure out the function description. Next, let's look at how we model with piecewise function. We'll do this through an example here. The cost of a long-distance data and phone call from Toronto, Canada to Mumbai, India is 69 cents for the first minute, and 58 cents for each additional minute or part of a minute. Draw the graph of the cost of function, C, in dollars of the phone call as a function of time t in minutes. As a rule of thumb, before we start graphing, we should figure out the domain for the function that is in question here. If we let C of t be the cost for t minutes, then because t is greater than 0, the domain for the cost function is a set of all t values such that t is greater than 0. That means we can only use positive t values to construct points for the graph. Well, let's just hypothetically think about what possible values we're looking at here. Start with, say, 1 minute. How much do you pay? Well, if it's within the first minute, that means we pay 69 cents. And remember, you're going to graph in terms of dollars. So we're going to convert the 69 cents to $0.69. But what about if you just make a call for 30 seconds? How much do you pay? Well, the 30 seconds is still within that first minute of call time, which means you should also pay 69 cents for that. And what about zero? If you didn't call at all, well, if you didn't call, then you wouldn't pay anything. But if you just call for 1 second, how much would you pay? Well, you still pay 69 cents for that. What it means is that as long as the t value is less than or equal to 1, you would pay 69 cents for that. Or if you called for 2 minutes, how much do you pay? That's going to be the 69 cents from the first minute plus the 58 cents for that second minute, or that additional 1 minute, which amounts to $1.27. What about if you make a phone call that is a minute and a half? How much do you pay? Well, if it's a minute and a half, that means you pay the 69 cents from the first minute, but for that 30 seconds of additional time, you would still pay the 58 cents, which means you still pay the same thing, $1.27, okay? So what that means is for any t value that is less than or equal to 2, but greater than 1, you would pay $1.27. Let's continue this exercise for just one more time. You now call for 3 minutes, how much do you pay? Well, it's going to be 69 cents for the first minute plus 2 additional minutes from that, and that's 2 times the 0.58, which gives you $1.85. If you were to call for 2 minutes and 1 second, you would still pay the same thing because we always round up. All right, so then this number is good for any t value that is less than or equal to 3 but greater than 2. What do you think the next one is going to be? pause the video and do this yourself. And I got for t-value between 3 and less than or equal to 4, I paid $2.43. Now let's graph this. It's always a good idea to lay down your coordinate system and label your units accordingly. The horizontal axis here represents the t-value, and we're doing this in minutes. The vertical axis represents the cost, which is represented by the variable c, and we're doing this in dollars. This first piece right here is good for t-value between 0 and 1, inclusive on the 1 but exclusive on the 0. So I'm going to put an open circle on the 0 and a closed circle on the 1. This is when t is equal to 1, this is when t is equal to 0. And the value is 69 cents, which is 0.69 if you consider this in dollars. So anytime if you're calling between the 0 minute and the 1 minute, you would pay a flat rate of 69 cents, and that's what that piece represents. Pause the video and try to finish the rest of the graph. Well, I get something that looks like this. For the second piece here, it's an open circle on the left and it's a closed circle on the right. And the value is at 1.27. For the third piece here, the y value is at 1.85. And the fourth piece, the value is at 2.43. The reason why we don't get a continuous function is because each partial minute gets rounded up to a minute. This is actually called a step function with jump discontinuity.